Thursday, October 25th, 2012, to order. Mary Ann, do you have the public notice?
I do. Notice that this meeting has been published in the Burlington County Times and in public notices posted at Burlington City Hall, 525 High Street, and at the Keegan Recreational Center, 522 Wood Street, Burlington, New Jersey, as required by law.
Okay, let's rise for the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Joe?
Let us pray that our mayor and various levels of city officials, and in particular this assembled board of the island managers, would be graciously granted the wisdom to govern among the conflicting interests and issues of our time, that we be granted a sense of the welfare and understanding of the needs of our people, that we be given confidence in what is good and fitting, and that we have the ability to work together in harmony, even when there is an honest disagreement. We ask for personal peace in the lives and the lives of all those here tonight. Lord, we ask you to bring home our troops safely to our family, and this evening, Lord, we ask you to keep Eddie Wilkins, one of our Burlington City High School students, in your prayers, who was in a serious accident. We ask all this in your name. Amen.
Okay, roll call.
Is Joe Zane?
Here.
Alex Carnavale? Nick Caruso?
Here.
Tony Caruso de Paula?
Tony's been excused.
Jim Cipriano?
He's been excused.
Murray Sunstein?
Here.
And Mary Morris?
Here. Okay, do I have a motion for adjournment time?
I'll make the motion for 9 o'clock.
Second?
I'll second.
On the question? Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Adjournment time has been set for 9 p.m. Okay, I believe the September 27th minutes were here last time. Do I have a motion to approve those?
Motion to approve.
Second.
Second? On the question?
On the question. Madam President, looking at the minutes, under negotiations, it indicates that there was a motion to remove the call for negotiations from closed session. And it was a little longer discussion than what is noted here. One thing in particular, that why did this motion come up? It came up because as chairman of the committee, I didn't request it on the agenda, and there's nothing indicating that in the minutes. I'd like the minutes to reflect that that this motion was made by myself because, as chairman of the committee, it was not requested by me, and I wanted to take it off.
Well, the truth of the matter, Joe, is that committee chairs do not set the agenda. The president does. The president does. Now, you can make a request as chairman of a committee to put that committee on the agenda, but if the president or board members want to discuss something, then that can be put on the agenda, and the president has the prerogative to do that. So there were no rules violated in putting that on the agenda. So I don't really see a need to add that.
Madam President, we're talking about the minutes.
Yes.
Of the meeting.
Yes.
The minutes do not reflect the overall conditions that were reported in the minutes.
But your complaint is that putting this on in closed session was not valid because the chair did not request that that be put in closed session. And what I'm saying to you is that you as the chair do not set the agenda for that, that the president does, and that if a member or the president wants to discuss something in the meeting, that person has the prerogative to put it on the agenda.
So
It is not invalid because you, as the chairman of the negotiations committee, did not request it.
Madam President, my objection or concern has nothing to do with procedures. It's about the minutes. I don't think there's a need to defend what you did. I'm just concerning myself about what the minutes say.
All right, so in other words, what you're saying is that basically the minute should be a transcript.
I don't think, Madam President, that they should be sanitized.
This is...
If we're on the question...
All right, why don't you, all right, you want to make a motion, Joe? Well, the motion's been made to accept the minutes.
The motion was made by you.
I made a motion.
What does he want to add to this?
He wants to add to the minutes that the developer negotiations was put on the agenda without his approval.
Not really, yes, that wasn't, Jill Downey, please. Minutes indicate that there was a motion to remove developer negotiations from closed session.
Okay.
Well, I would like the minutes to state that Mr. Abate made that motion since he did not request it to be put on the agenda as chairman of the lease committee. It gives further substance to the minutes. And I think it was an important part that was left out.
My only point, Joe.
That's right, my motion.
Fine.
Whatever you want to do with this one.
One question?
Go ahead.
Joe, you just want it noted that you didn't want it put into closed session, is that all?
Yes.
That's all you want?
I thought that's what I said.
So you just want a statement added that the chair of the negotiating committee requested that it not be in closed session when it was put on closed session. Is that correct?
However, it could be put in there. I would like it to be minutes to be put in.
Is that okay?
That's perfectly fine. Perfectly fine.
Okay, was it discussed in open session?
No. He made a request that it not be put in closed session.
That's what I'm saying. Was it discussed in open session?
That was discussed. That part was discussed in open session.
Okay, all right, fine. Okay, anything else?
Do we need a vote on that, or that's fine?
No, it was added to the...
Why don't you amend the...
I'll amend my motion.
Amend the motion.
The other concern I have is more procedure. And I'm not asking that we come up with questions and answers, but I just want to point out and indicated that at this time, Ms. Worth asked for volunteers to be the city council liaison, and a brief discussion follows. My question then is, so who is the liaison?
I am.
Great, but it doesn't say that in the minutes. That was part of the discussion, and I think it would be important that the minutes state that you are the liaison.
That's fine.
Okay.
And when you move down a little
further...
Where
is that?
That's right under the negotiations thing.
Which page? Okay.
Each two, I guess. And just a further example of, I hate to use this word, but the minutes being sanitized is the next thing on their website. Mr. Sunstein presents a brief update on the website, followed by a brief discussion. All that is perfectly true. But what happened? I believe, you know, anybody that reads this wouldn't know what it was about. And if you allow me to continue, that thing is continued when you talk about board future in the minutes. There is a discussion in reference to the board's future and finances. Okay, what happened? Who said what? Nothing is in there. And under old business, and I'll try to go on faster. So Mr. Bate offered an update on the thank you letter to Home Depot, and an update on the gentleman asked for an update, who offered pictures to the board. Okay, and nothing's in there. Mr. Bate asked if Mr. Corn will send his official letter of resignation. There's discussion on the matter, and nothing's in there. Mr.
Okay.
Bate suggested the board look for volunteers to seek to take over the secretary's position, and Mr. Bate asked for an update
right,
on the meeting of the
mayor.
I got it, Joe.
Maybe you
I'll
should
ask,
become the secretary, Joe.
No, but you know, somebody that's going to read these, you know, someday and try to understand what we did
if
or didn't do.
If you get any board's minutes, that's what they order, not a word for word.
It's perfectly fine, Nick, whatever you
guys
want to do.
You know what I mean? Go ask for open request to set a board education minutes. Go to a meeting,
okay.
Listen to what goes on, then ask for the minutes, and There'll be nothing of what was said.
Manager Caruso, I'm not a member of council or the Board of Education. Here's where I'm a member. People sent me here to speak on things that I might see.
So you want 10 pages of minutes every month?
I think they could be done.
No, we're not going to do that.
I think they could be done a little better.
All right.
I think you're delirious.
I think you're out of order.
I am out of order.
Do we have...
I am out of order.
Do we have a...
Did you get all that?
Do we want to table this?
Table what?
Do we want to table this approval?
Of the minutes?
Yeah.
No. We amended one thing. I'll agree to the one amendment.
And I'm ready to accept the minutes as presented.
Okay. All in favor of approving the minutes?
Aye.
Opposed?
No.
Okay. Motion passes. One objection. And this will be noted, this thing in the negotiation. Okay, we don't have minutes for the last meeting, for the October, I think that was the 11th. So we'll have to consider those next meeting. Treasurer's report. This is for September, right?
This is for September.
Okay.
Do you want me to read it, or I had sent it?
That's true, you did send it. Do we have a motion to approve?
I'll make the motion.
I have a copy.
I have a copy.
Point of information?
Can you see it? Okay, what we can do is, Mary Ann, why don't you go over? A couple people haven't seen it.
Beginning balance on the money market account, $8,922.42. Deposits, Wood Street Fair, $156. U.S. Treasury, which is the Coast Guard, $100. Credit, which is the interest paid, $148, for a total deposited of $257.48. Ending balance, $9,179.90.
Okay.
Checking account, beginning balance, $2,754.40. Zero income, checks that have cleared. One was for settlement to Getty, $2,000. Treasurer stipend, $75. Colonial Burlington, that was for Wood Street Fair, $25. Ending balance in the checking account as of the end of the month, $654.40. Scholarship fund, beginning balance, $21.53. Ending balance, $21.53. Woman account, beginning balance $787.65, interest paid was 16 cents, ending balance $787.81.
Okay, are there any questions about the report?
I don't think someone has a second vote. Did someone make a motion?
Do we need a motion? We need a motion to...
Did you make a motion?
Did you make
a motion? I'll make a motion to approve.
And I'll second.
Okay.
On the question?
On the question.
I'd like to compliment the treasurer for this new format. For myself, it makes it easier to look at each of the assets and expenditures, et cetera. And also, perhaps I can make a request after we go to acceptance.
Okay, anything else? All in favor to accept?
Aye.
Opposed? Okay, the treasurer's report is accepted. Mary Ann, did you say you got a bill?
We did.
Okay, I don't see any reason why we can't handle that now.
That's under correspondence.
Yeah, I know, and correspondence is next, but it also has to do with the treasurer, so. She's got a bill from Frank Caruso.
We received a bill from the Jasper Agency for the annual insurance. The bill totals $1,893.40.
Any So we'll have to put money in the account?
Yes.
Did that premium increase from last year? Because it sure sounds like it did.
All right, she'd have to look that up. She can have that information for us at the next meeting.
I hate insurance.
Let's see, is there, and we're going to have to, do we have?
You also have outstanding solicitor bills.
Okay, and what is that?
Let's see. Invoice number 52095, which covers 65 through 82. $1,357.80. $1,357.80.
What were the dates it covered?
65 through August 2nd. And then the most recent, invoice number 52096, covers the period of 8/6 through 8/26. And that total?
6 through 8/26.
8/26. That total is $1,304.20. So your total owed as of today's date? $2,662.
I don't think that's correct.
No?
I sure don't.
And what about the, do you have the woman, what about the woman bill? And how much does woman have left in the account? How much can we pay?
That was incorrect. Woman bill, invoice number 52097, is a total of $493. There was an outstanding balance previously of $1,079.
Okay, so basically what you did was you depleted the account and now she's $493 in the red.
No.
No.
No?
There's still $787 in her account.
Right.
Okay.
Might I add, please, that there have, first of all, I need to get the old records from when this account first started, because it needs to be gone through. I understand that the accounts were commingled at one point before they were separated into two bank accounts.
Okay.
Okay. And they need to be gone through, because on my looking through what I have in my possession, if I just went and added what has been paid, okay, under the woman one, it actually comes more than $2,500. So if there was not anything more than $2,500 that was put in that account, somewhere along the line, board money paid for something. Oh. And I can't tell until I go from the very start and go forward.
Okay, so we'll have to get, okay, so.
Well, that's because we weren't asked from the beginning to separate this account.
Right.
From the time that we were asked to be separate.
No, yeah, so it looks like it's a board thing. So.
Marion, correct me if I'm wrong, there's a $493 bill that's a fresh bill plus a $1,079 balance?
Yes.
So, yeah.
So the two of those together is $1,572.
And she has $787 in the account.
Correct.
$787?
$787.81.
Madam President?
Yes.
Yeah.
I think our issue was on the legal bills that were brought up to be paid, not the woman funds, although the woman's are important. Have we now substantiated that those bills are correct or not correct?
Yeah, I'm sorry. Yeah, they appear to be right.
Okay,
they were
so
the
these
reasons.
Bills are correct.
Okay.
Okay.
So these bills total $2,662 for us. And then, plus the insurance bill. How much is the insurance?
Insurance bill is $1,893.40. So overall, what is outstanding between the two is $4,555.40.
Okay, so what we need to transfer then is about $4,000.
No, I would suggest $4,600.
$4,600, okay.
That leaves you some in the checking, not a lot, but.
Okay, do we have a motion to transfer $4,600 into the checking account?
I'll make that motion.
Second? Nobody's seconding this motion. Can I second the motion? All right, I'll second it. And on the question?
On the question, that was, we want to vote to pay these bills because they deserve to be paid. But we have an emergency situation going on here, and.
We'll talk about that later, Joe. Right now, we have to pay the bills.
I have the floor on the question. And we're not going to sweep it under the table. We're not going to do.
We're not sweeping it under the table.
I have the floor, Madam President.
We're going to have a discussion about this. We have it on the agenda, Joe. Right now, I want to pay the bill.
I don't see it on the agenda.
We have got on the agenda about combining grants and fundraising and getting these two committees together to talk about a sustainability plan.
Okay, that's coming up after committees. We'll talk about it then. That's fine. That's fine.
All in favor of paying these bills?
No, it's transferring the money.
Oh, that's right, transferring the money to pay the bills. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Okay. Motion carries. I would also like a motion to pay Colson Eustavinus whatever it is that Woolman has left in the account, minus whatever it takes to keep that account open.
Could you repeat that? She wants a motion to pay.
I want a motion to pay Ron whatever Woolman can. They fall short of being able to pay him what they owe him, but we shouldn't be not paying him anything just because she doesn't have enough money in there.
Right. So why don't we take $750 out of that? Joe?
Madam President, it's been my experience that before you pay a bill, you take funds out of an escrow account, you share that bill with the person who put the money in the escrow account.
She has the bill. She has had the bill for weeks.
Okay. My point is that if there is any questions about it, normally that comes up. If there isn't, then it's fine. But procedure-wise, the bill should be forwarded to the person who put the money in the escrow account. And probably it would be a good procedure to get an answer if there's any concerns, yes or no, and have that as part of the record, and then pay the bill. Because right now,
any concerns from Woolman?
Yes, from whoever the person is to put money into an escrow account.
Okay, Karen, do you have any concerns about this bill? The last bill we gave you?
Not specific concerns, no.
Okay, do we have a motion to pay this, whatever we can out of?
I'll make that motion, that we take $750 of the $787 and put it towards the outstanding bill. Out of Woolman's escrow, towards the outstanding bill to Houston.
Okay.
Second.
We have a second on the question. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Okay.
Thank you.
Go ahead and pay that to Mary.
Okay.
Madam President, we just want to make a motion to pay bills, sir.
No, I would like it separated because I have to abstain on the insurance.
All right, the insurance bill. How much did you say that is, Mary Ann?
$1,893.40.
Okay. Do you have any recollection what that was last year? We can look it up.
Was it $1,800?
Okay.
It is due, the renewal date, so basically it's due.
What is the renewal date?
November 22nd.
November 22nd? Would you do a little research?
Sure.
Before the next meeting, because we'll have that first meeting in November?
Yeah.
And then we'll decide then what we're going to do with this? Okay, do we need a motion to table this?
I will make a motion to pay this.
She wants a motion to table the insurance.
Well, the motion's on the floor.
No, I know. Motion's on the floor and pay this.
Oh, that's what we're doing, okay, I'm sorry.
I'll second.
Okay. On the question to pay the solicitor's bill. Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Okay, now we need a motion to table the payment of the insurance bill until the next meeting?
I'll make that motion.
Second? I'll second it. Do we have anything on the question?
On the question, many times an insurance bill must be paid by a certain date, not just the renewal date. So it may be that this bill has to be paid prior to the renewal.
Mary Ann told us what the date was, it's November something.
That's the renewal date, but the insurance bill sometimes.
They may receive no later than November 24th.
Okay.
Yeah.
And it renews the 22nd?
Okay, I believe that was the only correspondence, right, Mary Ann?
Yes.
That bill? You can get it over there, yeah, you can get it over there, sure. Okay, anything else on the question of postponing the insurance payment? All in favor of postponing the insurance until next time? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Okay. And Nick abstains. Okay, committees, grants and fundraising.
Madam President, before you go there, under correspondence, there was a correspondence sent out by yourself to Drew Trevia, thanking him for the building supplies that Home Depot donated to the board. And you indicated that he could contact me if he needed something, but there's no phone number in there. I hope he knows my number.
I said at this address.
Right.
And the board's address is on there.
And what is the board's email address?
The email address is on there as well, I think, but the board's mailing address is on there. The board doesn't have an email address.
But there is a way to communicate with us through the webpage.
Okay.
And what's our webpage address?
All right, that's going to have to be fixed.
Yeah, so this is wrong. Yeah, I'll pass that down, please, so you have a copy.
I have a copy.
Okay, but that has to be changed. Or they won't be able to contact us.
Well, sure they can. They can write a letter to stick in the mail. But we'll have that changed. Okay. Grants and Fundraising Committee. What about the possibility of combining these two committees and having the members thereof meeting to discuss a sustainability plan? Tony and Murray and Nick and Don. Would there be a problem with that? And open that up for discussion.
I would be.
Well, no.
question, Madam President?
Sure.
Looking at our, I wanted to have this discussion during the treasurer's report, but we have some serious, serious problems that have been brought to our attention month after month by people in the public, like Jamie Zalot and others, that we have a financial crisis here. And once we take our assets and pay and the bills that we paid today, we've got $4,625 roughly left. The board is in the emergency room short to go on the life support. That's less than half a year. So the reason I bring that number and the severity of the issue to the board's attention, because it's directly connected to the success of those people who are doing grants and fundraising and sustainability plan. I would urge those people to be able to come back in 2 weeks and say, here's what we have. Now, since I'm urging people to try to help us, since we are in the emergency room financially, I wanted to see how hard it would be to try to find some grants and things of that nature. And I know I passed on to the president some time ago a book that I had from the League, New Jersey League of Municipalities. And that book was a wealth of information, including places to go to for grants. I went there this evening to try to get some information, which I brought to share with whoever's doing that. And it was interesting that a Sustainable New Jersey announcement today of $200,000 for municipal sustainability projects. And then it's Visit the League's Grants Resource Center. And it was addressed to the mayors throughout the state of New Jersey. I won't get into this a lot other than to say that there are websites here, there's addresses, you can go here and do the wonderful click, post, paste, whatever. So I'll pass this down to you and hope that whoever's on this committee realizes that, we are in a hospital financially and that we need to hopefully find some medicine that'll help us get better real fast.
That'd be great.
Can I make a request, Joe? Could you please help us? Would you like to join the committee? Why can't you?
1, 2, 3, 4.
Well, somebody will drop.
I'll drop.
Well, Nick will drop.
So that way there's not me and my daughter.
You seem to be really into this and you have a pretty good handle on it. Why don't you join us, Joe?
I would love to do that, but my businesses challenges are really increasing now. I am on the Committee for Community Service, and I'll give you a report on that shortly.
I know that, Joe, but everybody here works or is involved in something that takes up most of their time. You keep pushing on this, and I think it's the right thing to do, but I would really like to have you on it because you really have a handle on it. You know where to go. You've got all the enthusiasm. You know we're dying here on the vine, and we could use your help.
Well, I can tell you this, Manager Sunstein, that I've got 8-9 meetings left. I would be pleased to help you during the time I have left on the board.
Okay. Would you contact us and let us know when you have time to sit?
Sure. I would do that.
I appreciate that.
Yeah. I'll check the tab and see which one is.
Okay. All right. Community service, Joe.
Yes. I can share with the board. We are moving very well with community service. All the docks are stripped down. They are ready for the decking, which we're waiting for Lowe's in Mount Holly to give us that. The letter has been approved by the board, sent to the manager of the Lowe's. And if that equipment or material is not here for this coming weekend, I spoke to Don Reinhart and the gentleman from community service that is the skilled person. We'll be visiting. We're going to try to get him to visit the island somehow so that he can survey the area where this deck is going to go, which is another project that Mr. Trevilla said he would help us with. So that's 50% of the community service. The other part is the young lady doing, doing the reporting or recording. She's doing an excellent job. We're going to be doing a backup on the flash drives as well. So that while there is a lot of information on flash drives, computers are a funny thing. You never know what's going to happen with that flash drive. So we're backing up that as we go. And there is a wealth of information that keeps coming up about riparian rights, dredge spoils. You can get excited every time you open something where you can see things. Tonight, I brought to share with the managers two examples. One is from our former solicitor Dyer, John Dyer, I believe, and his opinion about riparian rights. And that brief is over there. Perhaps our solicitor, who probably seen it 10 times already, but that's there, as well as minutes from our former Secretary Walter Zimmerman. And that's interesting there because there was a gentleman by the name of Schultz who was our caretaker on the island. And when he was deceased, it shows the contacts and communications between the solicitors, etc., regarding that, as well as communications from the chief of police, the board of health, etc., when the tenants were removed from the island. So those documents that you have are going to be the very next thing that gets done. So she's doing a pretty good job, and I anticipate her to continue with that.
Okay, we're going to open this up to the public portion. Anyone who has something they'd like to say may come up. Please give your name and address, and you'll have 5 minutes to speak your piece.
Okay, Jamie Zayla. I haven't made any comments. Please appreciate it if you hold your comments to the end. Members of the board, 2 weeks ago I presented you with several options to fund the board through rough times that we've been all anticipating. For several months, I've been warning the board of its impending financial straits. I've also been telling the board about the lack of public participation at meetings. Recently, a local tragedy occurred. The local community rallied around the family. Within 24 hours, an online fundraiser site, a local bank account, and a beef and beer was set up. The point of the story is that with local support and belief in the cause, great things can happen. What is lacking is that in the board is that belief and support. Many people have come to these meetings and have seen the infighting, backhanded politics. They've seen nothing happening. There are rumors going around town that you're going to stop working with Woolman. What happens then? What happens to the lease with the city? What happens to the money that the board, what happened to the money that the board had? There was a lot of money in past years, and it's gone. These questions are the reason that the support of the town isn't there. I would like to know the answer to these questions myself. I'd also like to know what has been done with the ideas that I gave to the board 2 weeks ago. Has any movement been made? Have any committees been formed to move forward with the building of an app? Have you started looking into a crowdfunding site? There were also rumors going around that the board was going to do a beef and beer in conjunction with the Niagara. Has there been any movement made on that? Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, anyone else? Don.
Don Reinhardt, island worker, Burlington, New Jersey. Got paperwork here for, I think most of you saw today in the Burlington County Times about the grant money that was sent to all the municipalities for a variety of projects. I don't know why in the world we couldn't have been on there. I got a feeling that that was $5 million that were sent out and spent. And that was for 2010, basically, is when the idea was suggested. I know they have more programs in existence right now, and I think it would be important for us to get familiarized with whatever the freeholders are doing. We should be able to getting involved in them one way or the other. The other thing was that Manager Sunstein wanted pictures of the debris on the island from the fireworks. That's the picture that I just took just 2 weeks ago.
Thank you.
Then also, Joe was talking about the community service with the floating docks. Here's the pictures also that I took just a week or so ago of the quality work that the community service is doing, and obviously he's doing it for free, and we're getting the lumber and equipment for free too. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, Tom.
All right, Wayne Z, lot 506, Liberty Street, Burlington. I want to sit down, so can I?
Oh, certainly.
Thank you. Gee, with 9,000 people in Burlington, I guess, Don, my daughter, and I represent 3,000 people apiece. So that's interesting to know. But I have been looked at as a former manager. I'm here as a member of the voting public. And I have some concerns in that current, with this board's operations. Today, Mr. Bate covered a couple of things you brought up that I had on my list. I haven't seen anything on dredge spoils in a long time. I've been coming for the last 2 years, and I've not been a manager, and I haven't seen any progress on dredge spoils. I also haven't seen any reports on the reports that the city was supposed to obtain for what was in the core samples. No mention of it. Joe also mentioned riparian rights. This was something that I was very active on when I was president of the board. At the time, again, this is when John Dyer was with us, the state had offered to sell us riparian rights for $1 if everything moved the way that it was appearing to move. But it got stuck up with Mr. Katz. Mr. Bate put out some things about the minutes. The board, it's very hard to be on the board and to be the secretary. I did both jobs when I was up there once or twice. And it was really difficult. It's difficult for the person to hear everything and also decipher things and make decisions. I think that the board really needs to have a secretary so that all managers can concentrate on what they're doing. To be fully involved with the materials that are being presented. I see later that the board is going to thank Mr. Flatley for his help. I don't know why Mr. Flatley is leaving, but it is a shame that when available help is for free and it's a voluntary nature, that it shouldn't be continued. I'm concerned that, as I've been saying also, my daughter's been saying it, we don't converse and make one topic. She has hers, I have things that I have. But I've been saying for the last 2 years that the board is running out of money. And she had asked a good question, and that is if Karen is not going to be the developer, and this is what's been around the city. I'm sorry about that, Karen, but that's what I've heard. Then who's to replace her? What have you got in line? Is the board going to spend thousands of dollars again? Because I remember going through thousands of dollars from the money from the state that we did use to put ads in the New York Times and the Philadelphia Inquirer and the County Times also. Another thing that I have talked about over and over, and that is to get the lease with the city. I asked the board to do this a year and a half ago. Get the lease extended. It appears now that the city is not going to extend the lease. Why? Because they would like to use the rent, the land from the board, and they give the board a percentage of the money they make on the board side of the island, which if anybody accepts that, that's totally unacceptable to me. This board also has caused the FOBI to become inactive. We had a lot of volunteers here. We had people in the audience. We had people willing to do stuff. They're gone. I don't understand why the board has not accepted the manager's resignation, even if Mr. Carnival doesn't have a formal letter in. He's missed enough meetings that, according to what we had set up originally in the ethics committee, he's missed enough meetings that he should be asked to resign. So this should not be a problem there. Over and over again, and maybe I'm a stickler, I was a representative for the teachers union. Robert's rules are not being followed. The board accepted Robert's rules, and they do not follow them. Either dump the Robert's rules, or please try to be a little bit closer to what they're asking you to do. Two very important things. One is, you come out here, I take my time, Jamie takes her time, Tom takes his time, other people have taken their time, and we ask questions of the board and things that are reasonable. I don't ask about how much does somebody weigh, or did you go out on a date with somebody. We ask things about the island board, and we have no answers to our questions. I really would hope that the board would provide some answers. Two other things. One, I happen to, and I have a lot of island papers. Stella, when she retired, Stella Hotel, our former board president, when she retired, she gave me all her papers. The other day, I was looking through them. In the year 2000, the board had over $143,000 in 2000. In the 12 years since then, we're down to under five. So this is important that the board does find a way to get money. And my very, two more, I'm sorry. One is that when Leo didn't choose to run again, the board should have conducted by previous practice an audit of all the books, which would help out our treasurer and the questions that she had and that Joe asked of her. And also, I have an open request in, of which I did not hear anything. I thank you for your time.
I would like to see proof that this board had 12 years ago $140,000.
I'll bring you a copy of the things I got.
Because that's an incorrect statement. As long as I've been a member of this board, we never had that much.
We had.
I've been on this board 12 years. We never had $140,000. Guys got $60,000 from the Patagonia trees, and we've lived off it for 12 years.
And you also had money from Sam Katz.
You did not have $140,000 in the bank.
I'll show you the treasurer's report.
You need to look at that right now and bring it back. Because that's a false statement.
That's not a false statement. I'll bring it to you when I get a chance.
Before you leave though, Mike, you're saying that you submitted an open request to this board?
Yes, I did.
The open request number one, I have it right here. It has to be submitted to the keeper of the records, number one. Number two, I'd like to ask our solicitor if this is something that you're entitled to under OPRA. He's asking for copies of all of the emails between the board members for this year. I don't keep emails. I delete them.
This is not the board's form, for one thing. It says it up top, but it's the old form. It's still showing pages at 75 cents, which is not correct. It's a nickel a page. It's been that way for some time.
I've sent them the correct form.
Oh, did you?
I think when I started to answer the question, if you submitted a request, I seem to remember that about 2 weeks ago. I think you handed it to the president. It was the meeting.
Nick was presiding.
Mr. Kirk, Patrick was, sir.
Okay, so I seem to remember some of it, and I'm okay with that. So, the open request went to Nick 2 weeks ago. Now, here's my question, and I don't know the content of that. But here's my question. Under OPRA, is there a specific amount of time that the person needs to get a response to the request?
The clock starts to run when the OPRA request is delivered to the custodian of the records. And as far as I know, the custodian of the records on this board is Tony, is she not?
Yes.
So when Tony gets this request, that's when the clock starts ticking. Whether or not this is an appropriate request, I would have to look at. But the thing that first occurs to me is that it's extremely broad and very general because it calls for any/all emails between board members concerning island activities between April 2012 and October 2012. I'll be candid, I don't know what the applicability is of OPRA to emails between board members concerning island activities. But I'm happy to to take a look at this and provide the board with his opinion as to, you know, whether or not it's overbroad or whether or not it complies with the Open Public Records Act statute.
I think that would be a really good thing for the board to have your opinion on this as soon as possible. And regarding the time starting, would handing it to the acting president at that time be satisfactory, or must it be, because the treasurer, or the, I'm so sorry, keeper of the records, I feel like there's an action movie there or something, the keeper of the records wasn't here that night, I don't believe.
That doesn't matter. The form, the correct form.
So it can be mailed in to that person or faxed in or whatever.
But it wasn't.
Yeah, the correct form is a two-page form, and the second page of the form identifies who, that it goes to the records custodian, and it gives the mailing address as well as an email address.
I have to admit, I thought I was familiar with that more than what I am. Can you provide Mr. Zavot with the correct form?
Sure. I actually sent Jamie a copy of it months ago. Yeah. I emailed her a copy.
No, I wish I would.
Two email accounts.
There's the correct form.
But here's the correct form. You'll have that. Yep. And then we can move on and have our solicitor advise us.
So what we're going to do is spend money on the Soviet request that we don't have. And the same people that are telling us we're running out of money are causing us to spend money. I would ask for a motion on that, because I'll vote no to have that check. We're going to spend money to satisfy somebody that's complaining that we're running out of money. And they're costing us money.
Let me ask a question of the solicitor. When I get emails, when I'm finished dealing with them, I delete them. I don't have emails anymore. So, you know.
That'll enter into my opinion, yeah. I mean, because what has to be produced refers to the board maintaining files or records of these sorts of things. And as far as I know, unlike a lot of government agencies, at the county government level, the municipal level, this board doesn't have board email addresses. They have private email addresses. Is that correct?
Mm-hmm.
And they have private computers and email accounts that are their own. Is that right?
Yes, it is.
Okay. But I don't know, but these are things I'll have to find out in terms of giving an opinion on whether or not this is a legitimate request under the laws of New Jersey.
Would it be legitimate and his request for him to specify what he's looking for? I mean, he seems to be on a fishing expedition here.
Oh, Joe? If I can, two things. One, if we can put this to rest and move on, because we're running halfway through the agenda, but you'd have to close the public portion to do that. And regarding individuals asking for information under OPRA, this board has no control over that, nor does any other board. You know, this is a state law regulation that the public has a right to transparency and access to information. And while I agree with Manager Caruso that it could become somewhat costly, however, that cost is in fact transferred over to the person requesting that information. And I believe there's some flexibility in the OPRA request guidelines for that.
But you have to make the person. He's going to pay the solicitor's bill?
Well,
for the research that Ron has to do?
The request to the solicitor is to give you a legal opinion, just like other legal opinions. We just paid $3,000 in legal opinions.
What do you think?
So
that's his point.
Yeah, don't dance around.
There's no, there's nothing in the OPRA laws that allow you to recover the cost of legal costs.
So we're going to spend money to find out whether his OPRA request is correct, and every month they complain about this board bleeding the debt of money.
You'd have to appeal the OPRA law. If you want to appeal OPRA, you can try.
So, it doesn't matter. There are individuals that are complaining about the board is hemorrhaging money, and they're costing the board money. Just like when he contested who was running the election.
Let's not
dance around the facts.
Let me just say this.
It cost us $1,000
because he complained about the election that was legitimately run.
Let me just say this.
Then they come before the camera with their little camera running and want to tell the world that we're running out of money.
The same individual's got twice the years of service on the board, you and me combined.
It doesn't matter.
That's not relevant.
It doesn't matter.
This is a member of the public that has the right for transparency under OPR, and it's really...
I can tell you what's on my computer, I don't delete. And I don't care what OPR says, no one's getting what comes on my computer.
I'd be curious to know, in this information, does he want the emails that I got from Jimmy and I got from you that are pretty nasty? And the responses?
I
want this, doesn't that become personal? Or does that become some part of, what do you give?
I think asking how many managers does it take to screw a light bulb in also qualifies as nasty.
Joe, let's stay on target here.
So let's move on to the agenda.
Well, will you give up all your emails?
Let's wait for the attorney. If you don't want the legal advice, then vote that way.
I don't mind. I'm just curious if you want to give them up. The man's on a fishing expedition, and I don't know what it's about. And he doesn't ask, he just wants a blanket, give me all your emails.
Why don't you wait until you...
All right, we need a motion to have Ron research this matter for us.
Madam President, you're still in the public portion as we close it.
Oh, is there anyone else in the public who wants to speak? Okay, the public portion is closed.
Now you want to ask for a motion?
Now I want to ask for a motion to ask the solicitor to research this matter. Okay, having none.
Any questions? Do you need a motion?
There's no motion, so there's no question.
I'll make the motion to have the solicitor review it for the purposes of having the discussion.
Do we have a second?
On the question.
Define that again.
So we can get that question.
Define that again, Joe, what you just did.
It has to be seconded. It's not going to be seconded.
What did he say? What's the motion, Joe?
He wants...
My motion is to have the solicitor review it for... So that I'm making the motion so that we can have discussion on the question.
So you just want it, you want a motion so we can have a discussion?
Yes. On this issue.
And that's all you're asking for?
Yes.
You want, but you put the, do I have to vote?
You're either going to second it or you're not.
I'm trying to figure out what he's trying to tell me. So you're saying you want to give the solicitor approval to spend his time and our costs on checking this out so we can have a discussion?
If you'd be so kind, I'll just ask the question. Do we have options regarding an OPR request?
You love asking the wrong guy. There he is, ask him right there. Ask him.
Madam President, through you.
Well, I'm thinking that what I would do over the next 2 weeks is do some research and find out how to find these answers.
I would just like to state at the end of 2 weeks, and you know, the energy we put into this, we need energy put into other things.
That's no joke.
I really, really feel that you don't have a lot of options under OPR.
I understand that, but the OPR requires us to give up public records. My email account is my account. I pay for it. It's a private account, and after I'm finished with my emails, I delete them. Mike will get no emails from me because I don't have any. And I don't know if there are others on the board who are in the same position. But as to whether we are even required to give up our private emails, this board does not have an email account that we use to correspond back and forth to one another for the board. And so, to me, this is an issue that may not even be valid.
And let me ask another question. If somebody doesn't give up all their emails, is he going to give us a warrant to reproduce them? Where does that go?
Solicitor.
Where does all this go? We're all going to end up in jail?
I can tell you that about a year or so ago, gave you copies of the newspaper report. I think it was the township of Medford that was told they had to provide emails or something of that nature. And the article.
Township probably has an email.
Who cares?
And the article stated that you can't do business through emails and things of that nature.
Well, that's been stated.
That I remember.
That's been stated before, so, but you've been doing it as much as anybody else.
I've been active to try to move the issue forward.
And you put a disclaimer, that's right. And then at one point, you put a disclaimer on it.
All of my professional emails still.
So all your professional, so you don't have to give yours up? Is that the name?
All my emails have a disclaimer.
So you have to give yours up?
It's a legal opinion. I don't know.
Well, you put a disclaimer on it.
It's a matter of good business.
Oh, it's a matter of good business.
I'm going to do some research and I'm going to see what I can find out. In the meantime, since there is a question of the legality or the feasibility of this request, and I don't have any emails, but in the meantime, I would think it would be reasonable for you to give us the time to research this, Mr. Zalai.
This is invalid to return to another one.
Yeah, he hasn't got.
Well, yeah, he's got to turn it to the.
This is just a discussion. And I would like to ask Mr. Zalai, what are you looking for?
There's been a lot of stuff that I've seen from one spot or the other going across concerning board's operation. And that's public record.
Oh, so you've seen these emails?
I've seen some of them.
Where'd you see them?
That's my business. I do not have to tell you that. I've seen them.
Well, you can only have gotten it from one of seven places.
Not one of two places.
No, well, there's seven people in this board.
You know what? Look, you know what? Wait a minute. Wait a minute.
Oh, is it?
Wait, shut up, Murray. All right, Mr. Zalot has agreed to put a hold on this until I get the information I need, and I'll try to report back next meeting.
Thank you.
Okay, let's.
And by the way, just so you know, there's nothing in those emails that's going to give you any more information than you already know.
Because it's 583.
Okay.
If there are emails to start with.
I would like to address. As to our power to appoint a member, since Mr. I heard that there are some members who think we can make an appointment when someone resigns or dies or moves out of the area, whatever. And at this point, Joe?
Yeah, if I can, since I asked to have this put on the agenda, I think I can move it very rapidly. I wanted the conversation. In that Mr. Carnival has not been here for months. The board is in the emergency room financially. You need help. You don't have enough people to get things done. So how do we solve the problem without asking the board to spend more money for another election? The charter does give the board the power to make any and all rules, regulations, as long as they're not inconsistent with state law. Every school board, every municipality, planning board, you name it, if there's a resignation, they normally fill that position. Now, that person would fill it, I believe it's called the unexpired term.
Okay.
So we need to have that discussion about the resignation, and I don't think we can put it off any longer.
Okay, and that's what Mr. Houston is going to address right now.
The charter refers to three kinds of removal from office, whether for resignation, moving out of an area, death, etc. One involves the president, one involves the treasurer, and the other involves any other member of the board. And that's Mr. Carnival's position, as I understand it, that he's a board member. The section of the charter that addresses that issue says, and be it enacted that in the case of a vacancy happening by death, removal from the city, resignation, or otherwise of any of the said managers, it shall be the duty of the mayor of the said city, on the written request of seven of the citizens thereof, to call a legal town meeting for the purpose of choosing a manager or managers to supply the place vacant as aforesaid during the unexpired time of the manager so dead, removed, or otherwise ceasing to be a manager, which meeting shall be holden at the place and within the hours before mentioned, and the election shall be conducted by ballot as aforesaid. There is a section of the charter that also says that the managers and their successors shall have full power and authority to make all such necessary and useful orders and regulations, not inconsistent with the laws of this state, as to them may seem meet and proper for conducting the business of the said corporation, provided nevertheless that there be a majority of the whole number of the said managers present and agreeing thereto in order to make valid any such order, regulation, vote, or proceeding. The section I just read is immediately followed by Section 5 of the Act, which says that in the case of a vacancy, upon the proper petition to the mayor, an election will be held. The general term is 4. The specific term as to how you replace a manager could not be clearer. This board does not have it within its purview, legally, to ignore the section that specifies how a manager is to be replaced. It's a cardinal principle of statutory construction that the specific overrules the general. And although the board has the general authority to make certain rules for its operation, it does not authorize it to ignore its own charter as to how replacements are put on the board. And the only way to replace a resigning member, assuming that there was a resignation, is to have a petition filed with the mayor and for the mayor to set an election. That's what the charter says, and that's what the charter has never been amended to change. So that's pretty clear. I don't think there's any question about that, at least not in my mind.
I guess, Madam President, this is the where you get the rebuttal. I'll do it real quickly.
The
charter also said, and with all due respect to our solicitor, the charter also said that the hours of election were from 2 to 5. And had we not had a majority of the board to vote to change those election hours, thousands of people would not have voted in the elections for this board. So I think what the framers of this charter wanted was a general rule of what's in the best interest of the public. Not to fill a vacancy for 2 years flies in the face of efficiency, and I think it flies in the face of the future of this board. If a person does not complete his term, you then, if you follow the rules of the charter, you have to petition the mayor. If you petition the mayor, and the mayor decides to have an election 2 months from now, in my experience on the board, you're looking from 700 to 1,200 hours in expense. We're trying to make things better. You can eliminate that expense and then have that person serve to the next election when that comes up in April. In the meantime, you've got the manpower that you need. The majority appoints somebody that's on there. If that person wants to serve that interim term, fine. If they want to continue, let the public decide. In the meantime, we're looking for people to get things done. You said earlier, everybody's busy doing things. And I would submit to you respectfully, I'm as busy as the next person on this board. It's a sacrifice to serve. And things don't get done unless you take time away from something else. We need help. The charter says we have the right to make changes. This board made changes on election hours. And with all due respect to our solicitor, he told us not to do that.
I believe you.
He told us not to do that.
He did, and it cost us a couple thousand dollars after he contested the election. Go look at the legal bills.
Well, I'm saying that he told us not to do it, but I don't know who contested why. I think that's a different issue, Manager Caruso.
You do.
What we do have is the right for thousands of people who have voted since the majority did change that. And if you want to revert back, Manager Caruso, to the 2 to 5 hours, maybe you should put that in the form of a motion.
The same, the same 300 people vote every year, John.
Okay.
I'd like Ron to respond. The simple answer to that is changing the hours to allow more people to vote is consistent with election law. And there's a section of the charter that talks about handling elections in a manner similar to which other elections in the municipality are held. But I have to tell you, changing the hours of an election, whether or not it was appropriate, was done, and it was consistent because it was consistent with the same kinds of hours that the election polls were open for the general election or the school board election. This board clearly does not have the authority to appoint its own members. To suggest otherwise is to suggest that if the majority of the board left, those who were remaining could appoint the remaining members of the board, which clearly violates the charter, because the intent of the charter is that the members of this board are publicly elected officials. They are not appointed by anyone. They cannot be appointed by the mayor, they cannot be appointed by the governor, and they certainly can't be appointed by members of this board. That is crystal clear from the charter.
If I could just do a closing statement, with all due respect to our solicitor, I know the difference between kings and queens, none of them sit on this board, and what I would share with you, serving the public and appointing somebody to a vacancy to serve in the interim is a lot different than people getting together and saying, well, all seven of my friends are managers. Big, big difference, and I respect his position, you know, and mine is that we're not appointing people for a full term, we're appointing somebody to help serve a board that's in dire need. But you might not have to worry about this in 6 months.
I'd like to ask Joe a question.
Don't worry about it.
If I may. Joe.
Yes.
You seem to be the one that's really, really has the energy to appoint someone. Do you have somebody in mind?
Number one, I don't have anybody in mind. But number two,
I don't buy that either.
No, I don't. And you can make the best.
That's all I wanted to say.
I don't have anybody in mind.
That's all I wanted to say.
We've got a legal opinion.
I don't think we have a legal opinion.
No, actually, it's right down there in black and white in the charter. And if you want to make a motion, Joe, make a motion.
Well, no, I was happy to have the discussion, Madam President.
All right.
And it seems obvious. And, you know, I also know when I'm in a fight not to go against the overwhelming odds. And I know the vote's going to be to go against anything if I vote to give $100 bills out on High Street. I'm telling you that it's in the public's best interest to take someone who hasn't served this board after being elected to do so. And to appoint that position. If you have a totally different opinion, and if you want to hang your hat on the fact that the board doesn't have the ability to make laws, as long as they're not inconsistent with state laws, that's fine. In 6 months, you're all going to be out of money, and you're not going to have anything to do anyhow. But we need help. I'm trying to get you to help. I won't be here.
Yeah,
you need help.
Why you're leaving?
You need help.
Okay, but we're not going to go about it illegally.
All right. It's not illegal. I'm not suggesting something illegally. That's totally wrong,
too. Let's move on to the next thing I've got on the agenda is payment for interim services. And I would like the board I would like to hear a motion to pay Mary Ann for those meetings that she fills in for Tony. It's a lot of work. We're talking about tonight. Future meetings, at least.
Okay, but tonight and in the future.
Madam President, shouldn't the question come up first before the fact, rather than afterwards?
What? Well, she put it on.
Am I allowed to agree with you?
I appreciate that.
I don't know what that means.
It means if you were going to ask, we should have known about it before she done.
You know what she's asking.
What?
It's on the agenda.
I went over your head then.
I guess the point is that this is not a question.
If we were going to ask to pay her, shouldn't we have brought this up before we asked her to fill in?
Oh, I see. Oh, I don't know.
That's what Joe was saying.
It's a decent question.
We probably should have.
In other words, we assumed she was volunteering to do it. At least I did, and I'm sure that Joe did, too.
Well, I'm not assuming because personally I thought we should have paid her for the time Tony was in Europe taking those courses. But I wouldn't have a problem, you know, voting to pay her for tonight. But what's your pleasure?
Move the table.
I'll second that.
Question? All in favor of the table?
Aye.
Opposed, unopposing, okay, motion carries. We will bring this up at the next meeting.
Would that be proper to go into open or closed against the personnel?
Probably should be closed.
Probably should be closed, we think.
Well, no, you're talking about the expenditure of public funds and public expense.
Well, that's true.
I mean, that should be in open session.
All right. Okay, the next thing you asked for, Joe, is a letter to thank Tom Flatley. Would you like to draft that for me?
Yes, I would like to draft a resolution for the next meeting, basically giving thanks to Tom for his service to the board.
Okay, that'd be great. Okay, one thing I would like from Ron right now is just an update on the DEP letter that he sent out. Do we have any movement on that?
I have not received a response from, I assume you mean the letter to Mr. Applegate?
Yes.
No, I have not received a response, and I was not at the last board meetings to have the board authorize me to follow up on that. I'm happy to do it, but I have not gotten a response from him. This is the letter, just to refresh the board's recollection, dealing with the question of the mayor unilaterally preventing access to the island, even though a portion of the island is green acres, and that was the thrust of the letter. But I haven't received a response from Mr. Applegate.
Okay, what about, do we have a motion to authorize Ron to follow up on that, at least with a phone call?
On the question?
On the question.
Do we have the job? Do you want to pursue this? I mean, what I'm trying to say is that we know that the mayor legally, we all believe he's in the wrong. Our solicitor did some background on it. If you read the paperwork, as I have, it pretty much states that. That's not the court of law, it's the way I read it. Do we want to pursue this at this point? In other words, how far do we want to go? Do we want to spend the money? Do we want to start a fight? In other words, let's say Applegate doesn't respond, or says he has nothing to respond, what do you do then? Where are we carrying this? Where is this going? In your mind?
If I can respond.
Yeah, please, that's a mess.
I do believe that we should stay vigilant. I am, with all due respect to our solicitor, given our hemorrhaging of money, I don't want to spend any more money on legal advice. And perhaps what we could do is refer to the attorney's letter, and a letter from the board of the president, Mr. Applegate, and state, why hasn't this issue been responded to? And send a copy off to our Senator Allen, and our assembly. And try to see if they could, and request them to look into it as well.
Well, if I'm not
that
mistaken.
That won't cost us anything.
If I'm not mistaken, Senator Allen already has been informed and has said she was going to look into it.
Okay, so this is the vigilant part of it. It doesn't cost anything.
That's why I'm asking you, Joe.
Who is following up on it is my question.
That was my question to you?
Yeah, I don't have the answer, but I would suggest respectfully that the president. I think the president, with the approval of the board, take the attorney's letter, which cites dates, and if you feel comfortable, I can tell you that Mr. Applegate told me personally on the phone, I don't know if someone else in the audience was here, Mr. Reinhardt was in my office when the call came in, that there was at least 3 phone calls made to, and efforts to communicate with the city, and none of them was responded to.
Okay, so let me ask you this.
So if I may, just let's take to our senators and assemblymen the copy of the letter with an overview of the fact that the city has not responded, and that in fact this board has worked and is working to help solve some of the issues that the mayor has raised, such as safety. First responders will be able to get on and off that island 24/7 with the docks.
I'll make an appointment.
So I think that's how you handle that without spending money.
Is it the board's pleasure to see Diane Allen.
Well, I don't think that is code what you're saying. I think you're saying that you want to contact applicant herself, and he certainly has copies of